Hello everyone, welcome to this episode of Peace Talks. I'm so happy to be here again today with the amazing Simmone. She's gonna connect shortly. Today we bring a very interesting topic. I think this has been one of the hottest topics we've had since 2020, and that's COVID. So we're gonna talk about how regulations and how all of these are undermining our freedoms, and we're gonna talk a bit about the experience in different countries and also our own personal experience while traveling. So Simmone is already here. I'm gonna put her in. I'm here out in the woods. Hi, Simmone.
Hi.
How are you?
Good. How are you?
Amazing. Bit of a slow day apparently here on Instagram, but okay. Well, we still have fun talking, and I'm sure everyone watching this video later, either here on Instagram TV or on YouTube, will be happy to hear everything we have to say today. Thank you so much to those of you who are just connecting. Well, welcome, Simmone. Welcome. So nice to see you.
Gracias. Always good to see your pretty face. I see so Denny today has joined us. That's nice.
Nice. So just talking a little bit of the topic that we're going to discuss today, and that's how COVID regulations might be or are undermining our personal freedoms. From different approach, and we were talking about this with you last week on one of our calls. Hola Rudy. And because you were asking me about my experience traveling, coming to the US from Colombia, like the things that I had to do, what it was like in Colombia, and then we find out like things are very different, and you're from Canada, so you also know things are a bit different, but you've been in the US, in Hawaii for quite a time. So mm-hmm. So what is it like? What do you think? Are COVID regulations undermining our personal freedoms? Yes or no?
I would say to an extent, yes. And what I find the most fascinating thing is that you can be in the same country. So I've been living in Hawaii for quite some time. I work for a law firm that has offices in Arizona as well as Hawaii. I've traveled to California for my birthday. I've been to South Dakota for Freedom Fest. So I have managed to go to different states, and it is night and day. It's absolutely incredible. Like in South Dakota, COVID didn't even happen, let alone still exist. They're like, if you wear a mask, they will just, you know, everyone's packing some heat with their guns. Like you just don't, it's as though not only does it not exist, but it never happened. So there are this along those lines where nobody wears masks. They're having huge events, whether they're outdoors or whatever, like tens of thousands of people in stadiums. It just boggles my mind that, you know, we can have such discrepancies and differences in the same country. Now, Hawaii is one that is still quite, I would say, along the other end of regulation. So, you know, we've had mandates for quite some time. We're just starting to open up. I think it's actually today, strangely, it's today, November 3rd, that Hawaii has finally said, I believe it's for vaccinated, I think it's for vaccinated international travelers as well. I believe we're welcoming them back. And as I say it, I feel like, please don't quote me. I'll have to like triple check with the data. I know that today is a day where they're welcoming some sort of individuals. But then if it's just for people who are vaccinated, you know, where does that line cross? Does it apply to children? Now they've approved certain vaccines for children aged 5 to 7. I know that's another area where a lot of people are pushing back. They say, okay, maybe me as an adult, maybe I'll get the vaccine for whatever, whatever, whatever. But my children, you know, my children and my 5-year-old, we don't have the research yet. We don't know how this is going to affect their lives, their bodies, their fertility, or any of these other things. So even though I'm not a parent yet, I understand, I can you know, empathize with the parents who are like, I don't know if I want to inject my kids with this. I don't know if there's enough information that's available. I just got off of a call where you know, there was myself and one woman from Australia and a gentleman from the United States, the mainland. And we started bringing up the topic of the vaccinations and people losing their jobs when they choose not to get it. If they can't show that they've been vaccinated, they lose their job entirely. And so, you know, that is something that's happening in Australia right now. I know that's happening in many other places in the world right now. And, you know, they were on very opposite ends of the spectrum. And I feel like, again, as the Canadian, which is the Switzerland of the rest of the world, like the Switzerland of North America, if you will. And I'm kind of there. And I'm like, I see his point. I see her point. So I don't know what the answer is. But, you know, I guess when we always bring it back down to the principle, you know, should people have the choice to do their own research and choose for themselves what they want to do with their own property, their bodies? Yes, they should have the choice to choose, right? Now, as long as they're not posing an imminent or unnecessary risk to others. Now, I think that's where we're not exactly clear. Some things say that yes, and some things say no. And I think this gentleman said, well, if you're vaccinated, you spread it less. And I was like, do you though? Because if you're if you're vaccinated, you can still get COVID, but to a lesser degree, I think is the general consensus is that it may not kill you. You may not have to go, you may not have to be intubated, hospitalized. You won't be as much of a drain on the medical system. But the spreading, the ability to be a spreader, a super spreader, that part, I was like, I don't know if that is an accurate statement. I think we as humans that breathe and, you know, I think we have the ability
with
to
other humans. Yeah,
I think we all have equal ability
to spread any disease up to any extent. Because
what I actually like about, like I remember I used to do hot yoga and sometimes people would come and they're sniffling, they clearly have a cold and they still come and we're all sharing this hot air and breathing. And I'm just like, this mother, like, really? You know you're sick. You know you're sick and you know you're spreading those germs to us, but we didn't really think anything of it. So I think it's, you know, we've gotten to a point where a lot more people are washing their hands, hopefully,
I think
a lot more people are aware. Like, if I go out and I sneeze or I cough, everyone's going to kind of look at you a funny way, right?
Definitely.
I would say that's a good thing. What has been your experience, Maria?
Well, I think it's been... So we live in a complete different world after January 2020 with all of these COVID regulations. Like, and now I feel we're on the post-COVID reality. And if we think before all of this happened, we live in a very different world. Like, I feel things were much simpler, exactly for what you're saying, because we didn't have, we've always have this gray area. And I think that's where the principle is, where it's amazing to apply. But then we have these issues that are also like a moral responsibility. So with COVID, I feel that not only governments, but sometimes people that want to control other people because they want to feel in power, are using the COVID agenda in order to shame others. And now we live in the post-COVID era again, and now we have vaccines, and we have like a wide range of vaccines, and you can get the vaccines very easily. But now it's become the way to control us and the way to control society and the way to control how people, how individuals are behaving. It's not true. Through a lot of tools. But now I feel that COVID, it's very on our face and it's very clear how they're doing it, because it's not only something that they're doing through regulations and mandates, but it's also something that we have let ourselves get brainwashed into shaming others to say, hey, you didn't get the vaccine, so I'm going to be mad at you and I'm not going to be your friend anymore and I want nothing to do with you. And I feel that's also undermining peace in general. Because it's giving ammunition to family, to relationships, to fight over things that, this is relevant and, people have died and people are dying for COVID and we could all potentially die, but we can also die from many other reasons every day. And that's not enough to, I feel, to shame others and to be like, you know, and to me, that's very sad. And at least in my experience in Colombia, the mandates, the regulations, depending on the city that you were in and during the quarantine, they were very strict. I remember the first months of the quarantine that we thought that the world had ended, that we were going to live in the Hunger Games, that it was the apocalypse and so on, that you have to go to the grocery shop and you didn't know if you were going to get back. Like, it was insane. And right now, like, we're back here and it's like, okay, it's a new reality. We're in a new world. And I feel that sometimes when we stay in the same city, we don't feel the change as much because we all have those extreme quarantines. So things have started to loosen up in many cities. But then when you switch the cities, as you were saying, as you travel, and you're like, wow, they have a complete different reality here. What you were saying and what's really saying here about that in Houston with the mask and so on, it's like COVID never happened. And it's like, oh, nice. Like, I have to wear a mask or be shamed on the streets because I'm not wearing a mask, which sometimes happen in Colombia. Like, people will look at you, especially in Bogota, people will look at you weird if you are not wearing a mask on the street, which to this point doesn't make sense. Many people in Colombia, although we're on the schedule, and I personally got the vaccine because I wanted to travel and I didn't want to have any issues with traveling. Some people are choosing not to have the vaccine, but the government is not asking restaurants or bars or places to ask for the vaccine in order for you to do stuff.
This is in Colombia.
This is in Colombia. Yeah, this is okay. In Colombia. And then I came here and I was in DC and I was in New York and I was also speaking with a friend in Seattle before coming here. And I heard he was very upset over the vaccine mandates. And he was very upset, like, no, they're forcing me to get the vaccine, la, la, la. And I was like, I mean, just get it or don't get it. That's fine. I mean, just find then another place to live. If that's triggering you so much. But then I came here and I realized, like, I saw the reality he was in. And it's that if you want to do anything fun, let's call it fun, you do have to get the vaccine, at least in DC, New York City. And you feel the tension, you know, you feel the tension. But also it's like, who's watching over these regulations? Because we did the test with a friend. She's also from Colombia. In Colombia, they give you this a vaccination card, but they also register you on the databases. So you have like the digital one with the QR code, and if they check, you're on the database, da, da, da. But you also have the paper one. So when we were to the places, we show the paper one and they will let us in. They wouldn't check anything. And this, I don't have it here, but that car looks like a 5-year-old made it. Simone, I think you saw it, right? And it's like, and they don't check. And it's like, don't do this at home, please. I'm not saying that you guys should do this, but all I'm saying is these regulations, and that's the thing, when government starts putting this type of regulations, I can see the face on the waiters and on the people on the bars and the clubs or so on. They don't want to have something extra to do by checking your vaccination card. They just want to like sell, and they just want to have their businesses open. So it's pretty insane right now. I'm in Santa Cruz in California, and at least here in Santa Cruz, things are very laid back. People are not wearing a mask. They're not asking you to wear a mask to be on a restaurant and so on. But I'm hearing that in San Francisco, things are very different. As much as in LA, I'll be there soon, so I'll report back to you guys. But that's the thing, when you switch countries and what you're saying, even inside the US, because you're a federal state, things can change from state to state. As in Colombia, it's a bit different because we're a republic, so everything kind of like it's the same in every city. But it's insane how you pretty much feel in a different reality, like you're living in a different world. And I feel that those differences also impact the way we interact with other human beings, and the result of building a peaceful world, you know, because if you see someone different than you, you might feel threatened. But also if you know, like, other different people, there are different realities, and where I'm living is not the whole truth of something. And again, what you were saying, it's not about like, if like the thing here in the US with the vaccine, I feel it has gone a bit extreme, because now to enter you have to get you have to be vaccinated. But I was reading that they might even ask if you want to leave the country, you have to be vaccinated as a citizen.
Wow.
But I don't know about that. Like I saw a headline like that. I don't know if that was a clickbait. I didn't have time to go through it, but it could go to that extent. It could go to that extent. Wow. And that's what I'm saying. It's another way to control borders, and it's another way to control humans voting with their feet when they're not happy with the situation. You
see? I've never heard that, you know, having people be vaccinated in order to leave. I feel like that's going to create a lot of chaos, because now they're limiting your actual freedom to go and say, you know what, I don't like what this government is doing here. And then the argument could be, well, you don't like it, leave. And now they're saying, you can't go.
You can't go.
Yeah,
that's
get the vaccine.
That's the thing.
That's very scary to me.
Rudy Rico is asking, where in Hawaii are you?
Oh, I am in Honolulu.
Honolulu. Wonderful.
Yes.
Yeah, totally. But it could go to that extent. And I feel nowadays we can die every day. We can die out of anything. It can be anything. And I feel that COVID is not, because it's the worst threat that we had as a humankind, but it is a really good excuse for governments to keep pushing what they want to push and to maintain people under control.
And I feel like this is not going to be a popular statement, but I feel like before COVID, it used to be politics. So you could have family, you know, Thanksgiving dinner ruined because half of your family is a Democrat, half of your family is Republican, especially when there was other people, you know, in power. And it was very, people were very opposed, where they'd literally say, I'm not friends with you anymore. You are no longer considered my family because of how you voted or how you feel politically. Yeah. And then I don't know if you saw this, but I feel like that was kind of dissipating a little bit. It wasn't as, you know, black or white. People were kind of in the gray, or they just didn't care as much. You know, politics wasn't as much of a thing that could really just tear families apart and, you know, cause people not to be friends, colleagues not to like each other. And so they were like, guys, we need something. We need something to divide these people. Otherwise, they're going to realize how much power they have. What are we going to do? And then so this whole thing with the, you know, the vaccines and the mandates and the masks and the shutdowns and all of this stuff, I feel like is the new government. It's what has the ability to be like, oh my gosh, you didn't get vaccinated, or oh my gosh, you got vaccinated, you're so impure now.
Yeah.
And just like right, so people are so on the extreme of this matter, and you know, I find it saddens me a little bit. It saddens me that we can't just allow people to have their choice and respect their decision for whatever reason, you know. And I think we discussed this in a previous episode where I said, a good friend of mine, we do not see eye to eye politically, but I care about her so much. And we have such a good time. And we have so much fun. Why should I not be friends with her? And even people were like, you shouldn't be friends with her because she believes in this. And da, 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 da. And I'm like, that is ridiculous. It's so ridiculous.
It is. And I think that's the point. Like, the reasonable people of the world need to get together. And I think this is exactly the point. They're trying to portray, and usually it's like, in Colombia, it was the same, like the division between, oh, you voted for this, or you support this, or you're not invited to my house anymore, or you're not my brother anymore, or things like that are so extreme. And it's like, politicians don't even care that you're that passionate about any of them. They don't care. And I think that's when the trial principle, and that's what to me personally appeal me about live and let live, and to have a real global peace movement. Because sometimes you see these let's I don't know how to call them in English, but you have
Try in
other
Spanish. Let's see if I can figure it out.
these other peace movements, that usually
Okay.
come from the right, like the human animal rights and all of this stuff. And it's like you're bringing more division, because it's like you don't think like me, so you don't get to be my friend, or you don't get to be someone that I respect because you don't think like me. And that's just so insane. That makes no sense to me. And with Live and Let Live, we have one simple principle. If we don't see eye to eye to morals or the values, doesn't matter, because we do still have a tool to live peacefully, and that's the non-aggression principle. And I feel that again, bringing it back to the vaccination, because again, this is a question that Mark gets asked every time that he's on an interview. I'm sure if you go to our YouTube channel and go through the interviews or to the Peace Radical podcast, you'll see how much we've asked this question to Mark. Like, it's vaccination, that vaccination is required, violating the non-aggression principle. And he's like, that poses different perspectives, and it's a topic that we still have to talk more about. And everyone who's connected, everyone who's watching, we want to hear your opinion. We want to hear what's like in your countries, because I feel the mandates. I do feel that personally that the mandates are getting a little bit out of hand, and sometimes I can potentially threaten peace and liberty in general.
So I
You're
don't know
looking
if
confused. We have
you
a bunch of comments, but
yeah that's what I'm trying to
Envy says, you nail it. Spark the power. Simone, yes, Simone. Yeah, you nailed it every time. So
okay
I'm Maria Alejandra, and this right here is Simone. For those of you who are new here, for those of you who are starting to follow us.
oh yeah I
And
guess we
yeah, I'm
never
still
say our
thinking.
names.
Yeah, like we're like, oh yeah, I'm just live and let live, some other random person that is doing lives on Instagram, but
Well,
yeah.
I do want to address what Rudy Rico has said. He said, we don't abide here in Texas. We have too many guns. Oh, already. We don't let someone tell us what to do. And we don't want liberals as friends. Okay. I agree with that you have a lot of guns, and so you don't want people to tell you what to do. I think that when it comes to politics, and this is just my opinion, this is, Simone's opinion, that there's so many different facets and topics within one overarching political party or one, right? There's so many different things that we don't even have enough time. I don't even have a watch, but I'm pointing as though we don't even have time to go into every single topic. And what I will say is, even if you may sway towards a certain political party or a politician, there is a 0% chance that he is going to be on point and you're going to say yes to every single topic, every single platform, every single subject that one politician has to say. So what I'm trying to say is that if somebody believes that they're this, and I don't like to really put a name on anything, I hate people trying to put me into a box, but if somebody believes they're this, a D, someone believes they're an R, or whatever in between. I don't really care what you state you are or what that means to you, because I don't think that's the only thing that defines you as a human being. I want your actions to speak. And is this a type of human being that I want to be friends with at the end of the
Totally.
day? Like, we don't have,
Totally.
like, also keep in mind that certain subjects, like what do we think about Social Security and paying out to like people who have worked their whole lives and contributed to something their whole lives. But if we're young and they're old, and it's going to be the older people who have contributed for years and decades, and now they're going to be paid out for all their hard work. But I'm young and I don't care because I haven't contributed anything. Obviously, we may not see eye to eye, but that doesn't mean that we have to hate each other. That doesn't mean that we are necessarily on opposing sides at all, because when I'm older, I'm going to want that Social Security because I'm going to say, hey, I paid into that, right? Or if they're offering incentives and they want to increase the child support, but I don't have children right now, I'm going to say, well, why am I going to spend all this money and pay extra taxes because all of you guys have children and I don't, right? So I may not disagree with the overarching role, but for right now, where I am in my life, it may not apply to me as much. And that doesn't mean that you're wrong because you believe that, because maybe you have kids, or maybe because you're older, or because of this or that, because I may be there one day. And again, I don't even know if this makes sense, but at the end of the day, I just want to say, who is Mariale? Who is Maria? Do I like her as a human being? Do I think her actions are speaking in a way that I'm like, yeah, she's a cool person. I like what she's up to. She seems like a good human being. I would like to be friends with her. And it doesn't matter about all the specifics to me. I know that other people don't feel that way.
I love the point that you're making, because at the end of the day, it comes down to that. Action speaks louder than words. And sometimes all of these people haven't had Maria Alejandra. It's okay. Some people haven't had the chance to learn something different. Because I have so many friends that went to different universities that have a different background than I did. And they don't know anything about the non-aggression principle. They don't know anything about libertarianism. They've only known about Keynes and Marx. And that's it, because that's everything that they've learned so far. So it's important to be open, to be open-minded. And what you're saying, hey, you're a good person. Like, and let's base ourselves on actions rather than just words or a color or a state or a nationality or something, because at the end of the day, that doesn't matter. What matters is what you're doing to build a more peaceful world. And I think that's great about the non-aggression principle, because if we can agree on that, if we can all agree on that, like the countries, like the communities can agree on that one principle, then we can just all be friends. I'm sorry if I'm being too optimistic, and if I'm bringing like a much lighter, like a different perspective. But politics, it's exhausting. Like I've had the experience. I've been inside campaigns, and it's exhausting, and it gets you nowhere. As working in real projects, helping real people, that's what changes. And I had friends that are extremely radical, like very radical, and I maintained my friendship with them, and they started seeing what I was doing inside the network, what I was doing to live in a more free world, in a more peaceful world. And they were like, hey, you know what? I like what you're doing. I'm going to be down for that. And that's the way you change the world, one person at a time. And it's with your actions, not with the opposite, you know. And here, pineapple kimchi. I love this handle, pineapple kimchi. Glad to hear smart women getting tired of the radical brain dead feminist. Yeah, and that's the other thing. Sometimes we take the issues and the positions to an extreme, and we often forget that on the other side there's a person, and that maybe that person is reacting in a bad way because they're hurt and because they cannot live at peace with themselves, you know, and that fighting over the vaccine or the mandates and so on might just be hiding something else. So it's always, I mean, if we want to live in a peaceful world, let's all please remember first that we have a human being in front of us. Let's start there. Okay.
You hit something really important too. It's like you said that we can't begin to affect one other person, but really we can't affect anybody if we don't work on ourselves first.
Totally.
Right?
Yeah.
So I think working on ourselves to make sure that we're not just projecting and making other people wrong is also really important. It's like, what is the saying? Don't those in glass houses shouldn't throw stones? It's like, check yourself before you
throw the first stone. Yeah, yeah, yeah.
Yeah. Uh-huh. So
yeah, and I think it comes down to that.
I always try to be aware and conscious of my how I'm, you know, affecting other people, and it may not always work 1,000%. But you know, I try to be aware of it in everything that I do as best I can. I mean, I'm only human, right? I'm never.
We're all humans. Like, there's nothing else, you know. And it's okay to be wrong sometimes, and we will figure it out. But that's what I love about Live and Let Live. That gives us that ground, like that neutral point of okay, this like the non-aggression principle. That's it. But also to be a live and let liver, that implies that you live your life by a certain set of values. And many of those values are open-minded, be reasonable, always seeking for the truth. And what I've seen on Live and Let Livers in our network, in our members, in also in chapter leaders around all around the world, is that they're always open to have a peaceful conversation and to say, and as even Mark says, he says that himself, hey, let's discuss this. And if I'm wrong, I mean, I can always change my point of view. We're always changing. We're always growing. So, and I think I don't think
everybody feels that way, though. I wish that everybody was as open-minded and tolerant. And I think that is one thing that attracted both of us to this movement, is that willingness to say, you know what, I might be wrong. And if I am, prove it. Show me. Give, like, you know, convince me that what I thought was true is no longer the case. And if that's the case, then I'll change. I think that is incredibly valuable as for a human being to be able to say, you know what, I acknowledge the fact that I might not have all the facts and that I might be wrong. And if someone is able to convince them that they're willing to change, that is huge. Like, to me, that doesn't happen enough. I wish I would see more open discourse and saying, you know what, without just like everyone just being like, ah, you're wrong, I hate you, and just, you know, really people feeling safe to be able to discuss things openly, because I think that's what's missing. We might say, okay, well, what is everybody else gonna say? Okay, more people are on that side, maybe I'm gonna choose that one, right? Because we all want to feel this sense of community. We want to all feel accepted as human beings. I think that is why organizations like, you know, the KKK and ISIS and gangs and everything are able to get these people who just really feel lost and they don't feel connected and they're searching. They want community. They want this human connection to some other people. And they say, okay, these people are willing to accept me into their fold. I'm going to be part of this group, part of this community, even though it may be something very radical. You know, and I think I do want to mention the latest Peace Radicals podcast that Mark and Andy did, because they interviewed Dr. Zudi Jasser, and they're trying to uncover the idea behind radical Islam. Because Live and Let Live is a non-denominational, like, we don't care what religion, we don't care what political party, it doesn't matter. Just be a good human and don't aggress upon other people.
Like, that's it. It's simple. It's so simple. It's so simple. But I also want to add something. It's so simple, but sometimes, like, yeah, I'm sure you heard this, that the least common sense is the common sense, you know? So sometimes that takes, like, perspective and saying, hey, let's all take a step back and rethink the way we're acting. But also regarding the non-aggression principle, something that I want to make also clear here, that being a peace movement, the real global peace movement, is that the non-aggression principle also implies that if aggression is being, it's happening, you have the right, the total right to defend yourself, or just to simply stand up and walk away. You know, we're not saying, hey, you have to stay and convince and, like, take on other people. Like, no, like, if your friend that doesn't agree or that does agree with the vaccine and the mandates, it's being annoying and you don't feel comfortable, then just stand up and walk away. And that's what I said to many friends here in the U.S. who were having a hard time on their states and they had the chance, they had the ability to leave to someplace else. And I told them, okay, if this is triggering you, why don't you go to a place that doesn't have this? And in your own country, you have that, you know? And sometimes we choose just to stay to prove a point. And sometimes the aggression principle also implies, hey, like, this belongs to you. You're not willing to listen. You're not willing to have an open conversation. You're not willing to discuss this peacefully and with facts. Then I'm going to leave. I'm going to move on. And I think that's also important to keep in mind when you're talking with someone about anything. And if you want to be a live and let live, you know, you live and you let live. If they don't want, you know, if they don't want to listen, you just have to move on. Because
know which battles are worth fighting.
Totally.
Yeah, because totally. None of them, not all of them will be worth the effort or time. Sometimes you know, and I'm sure you've experienced this as well, as I touch my hair to the person who doesn't like that we touch our hair. you know, sometimes people, no matter what you say, they already know they're against you. Mm-hmm. It doesn't matter what you say. You could say the sky is blue today. No, you're wrong.
The sky is actually green.
they just don't like your face, or they don't like you, or for whatever reason, they already know that they're against you. So is it worth it to really just, you know, you're like beating a dead horse at that time. Like, you're not going to change their opinion. You're just going to get angry and frustrated yourself. So maybe it's just, okay, I respect your opinion, and I'm out, you know?
And I'm out. Yeah. And I don't have to stay there listening. Yeah. Crazy. Cause I've been there many times, and you have people that is very pushy, and sometimes you have to choose civility. That's another of our values, and to just be a lady, be a gentleman, and keep your way. But that's the way I feel that live and let livers do it. And sometimes it can be draining, and it can be very, very, very difficult. So Pineapple Kimchi is asking, any reactions to Dave Chappelle special? Funny you ask, because actually Simone and I will record an episode. I think that's episode. This is episode 6, so that'll have to be episode 4. It's on RGTV, and it's also on YouTube. So after we finish this, you can go check that out. We talk about Dave Chappelle's special, and we also talk about the Britney Spears case. I don't understand this question. Well, yeah, I mean, I feel that the point of being against or pro someone, again, like, it's just a label. And from the live and let live perspective, is first live. I mean, people want to be free. People want to be at peace. What's your biggest dream? Start a business, have a family, have a dog, travel the world. What's your dream? And what we've come to realize is that all the central power, the government, and so on, sometimes stop people from fulfilling their dreams. So it doesn't matter if you're from a red state, from a blue state, if you're black, if you're white, if you're this religion, other religion, we all have a dream. That doesn't imply that we're going to have to aggress someone else. Mm-hmm. And as long as we can agree on the non-aggression principle, we can all move on and make this world a better place. But that takes time, and that takes patience, apparently, a lot of patience. Yeah.
Yeah. So I do want to address again, Rudy is chiming in here. Well, then you get to the point that you are with us or against us. And I think the point that we're trying to make is that it's not really about that, at least for me. You know, Maria, you can speak for yourself, but to me, I don't want to have a, you're either with me or you're against me. All live and let live is saying is that don't aggress against other people. And so if you're like, yes, I agree with that. Now, again, self-defense is absolutely within your power, and you should be allowed to defend yourself. If somebody's aggressing against you and they're going to punch you and they pull a gun to your face and they're going to kill you, of course you should be defending yourself. But if somebody is peacefully striving for their own happiness, doing their own thing, not posing any risk to you, not forcing you to do anything, but morally what they're doing or ethically what they're doing does not sit well with you, the live and let live movement is saying, I respect their ability to pursue their own happiness in any peaceful way they see fit. So if you can determine for yourself whether that means that we're with you or against you or however you want to put it, you can do that. But we don't see red versus blue, black versus white, this versus this. Are you with me? Are you against me? We just subscribe to the principle. Don't aggress against other people. Like, that's, we're trying to make it simple, because we're not all going to agree on what is morally and ethically right or wrong. And we shouldn't have to, because I believe if we're all out there doing our own thing, just peacefully pursuing whatever brings us so much joy, if we're so happy with our lives, we're not going to be so concerned with whether other people are doing exactly what we want them to do, what we think is morally or ethically right. We're not going to care, because we're going to be so happy living our lives, pursuing what makes us happy. And so I'm not sure if I'm answering your question, but I think it's not really about you versus us versus them. If you don't see that, then you need to wake up. All right, and that's your opinion. See, this is me peacefully saying, you know, I'm trying to make the point of I'm just out here trying to find my own happiness, and that's okay if you don't see the same way. You don't have to stick around and watch this. That's within your right. See, isn't this a beautiful, beautiful world we live in? You don't have to stick around and watch something if you don't agree with what we have to say. Or maybe you do stick around, listen to what we have to say, and at the end, think about it a little bit more. Things that make you go, you know what I'm saying?
Totally. Yeah. Open-mindedness. That's, I think that's my favorite value from live and let live. But I feel we've gone a bit out of topic here.
We have a bit indeed.
Of vaccine and COVID mandates, but I wanted to bring that during an interview that we did on Contrapoder that was on Spanish. So if you want to watch that, go to our YouTube channel as well. Now every conversation comes down to vaccine or no, like it's okay, it's not okay. And we were talking with Esteban, the host of the program, and I was giving him my experience in New York and in Colombia, and he was talking about his experience in Florida. And I think he was saying that in there, the restaurants they don't have a choice. They just have to let people in, even if they don't have the vaccine. And I feel that's the other side of the coin on the regulations and the mandates, you know, because to me, that's still an aggression. Because what if a restaurant owner or they don't feel comfortable letting people in the restaurant if they're not vaccinated? That should be up to them to decide. And I forgot the name of the state and I left my notes inside of the house. But I know there's I'll put it in the comments. In that state, they made it illegal for the government to decide whether or not places should ask for the vaccination card in order to let people in. And I think that's the better 3L approach, like the live and let live approach that I'll say we should take. And it's the government shouldn't decide. It's up to individuals. It's up to the communities. You know, it's up to your local community. And that's what we're trying to promote, that communities decide on these issues, because sometimes the government and bureaucrats are not there to see the reality. Again, what we were saying earlier, like if you change cities, it's another reality, it's another world.
Right.
It should be up to the communities who are on the place, who know what their issues are, and they know better how to solve them without aggressing anyone.
And especially if you're a private business and you want to run your business in a certain way and you say, yes, I'm okay with unvaccinated, vaccinated, you know, I don't care who you are. You want to spend money in my establishment? I welcome you. I feel like that should be their right. I feel like that should be their right to do that. That's open commerce. You know, they're making the choice for themselves. Mm-hmm. The people who are choosing whether or not to be a patron of that establishment can also choose for themselves. Do I like what they're selling? Do I like their morals or whatever? I mean, I just don't like the idea of this one entity, overarching entity, thinking that they know everything and making decisions and just coming from a top-down level. Because again, with, whether you have children or not, and you agree with, incentives or government whether you have kids or not, or Social Security for those who are on the precipice of retirement. We're all in different stages of our life. And while we may agree or not agree with certain things, depending on where we are in our personal stage in our life is what we're going to probably align with, right? Because that's how it's going to affect us personally. Mm-hmm. So when it comes to businesses, it's like, you can choose. I think we each should have our choice. Do I want to let these people in as customers if they own the business? And as a customer, we can also choose, what are they about? Do I want to be a customer of theirs? End of story. It's like free choice. It should be free choice at the end of the day. And I don't think we have that enough, unfortunately.
We need more free choice. It comes down to that, and free markets. We only need to agree on the non-aggression principle, and that's it. Communities are up to decide, like to give the power back to the people. We've never had it. Like, we've always lived in this crazy either feudalism or like democracies or so on, and it's like it's time for something better, it's time for something new.
I think we can all agree to that statement that if COVID has taught us anything, it's that whether we like it or not, the entire world is connected. You know, we would see parts of this. Like, I remember being in Korea and people were wearing face masks. This was in 2017, so way before COVID. So I was in Seoul, I was doing comedy there, and people would be wearing these face masks. And I was like, what's going on? Number one is sometimes they would wear face masks if they were sick because they didn't want to make anybody else sick, which I was just like, wow. Mm-hmm. Like, clearly that's a very collectivist society.
Tell that to your yoga buddies.
Exactly. But then also it was because there would be yellow dust that would fly in from China. So China is very industrious and they're always all the factories. Mm-hmm. And so the pollution, depending on how the wind was blowing, would come into Korea and you couldn't see, the air quality was very bad. So for us to be in whatever country we're in, doing our thing, thinking that we're not affecting anyone else, is just not true. And I think COVID has demonstrated that to everybody, to the whole world. Like, our actions do affect everybody else. So that's why we just have to be a little bit more conscious, a little bit more aware of what we're doing, not just because it's going to affect us and our immediate community, but it is going to affect the world at large. So,
and it's also to be compassionate, you know, to be aware and compassionate of other people. Like, if we want to live in a peaceful world, we all understand that we're in this together. And making it black or white is not going to help. It's not going to help.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, again, I think the people who can't seem to understand this point is because they have some conflict within themselves. And if that is the case, it's like, I was there. Oof, people who knew me when, oh my goodness, people who knew me when I was a teenager, even in my 20s, I was so angry because I hadn't dealt with, you know, I hadn't managed to resolve the trauma that I had experienced. I didn't know why I was so angry. And so I just lashed out at other people. And I really wanted to fight. Like, I was just like, try me!
You were angry. Ah! Angry at the world. Of course, yeah.
I was so angry. And I thought I was so badass, and I was just like, I really just want to punch you in the face right now. And it's so funny to see that, like, me now, I feel like I'm quite
a different peaceful person.
Yeah. But that, you know, it takes time. We grow, we change, we evolve. That's what life is. It's like, I feel like life is a mix of the experiences that we experience. And then the process of seeing, how do we deal with it? How do we overcome it? Do we become better? Do we let it take us captive for the rest of our lives? And that's why at this stage, you know, there are things that would start to come up and I'm like, oof, no, I don't want to deal with that. So I'm just going to keep pushing it down, you know, just stay down there and be toxic to my body and to my brain and to my everything. Because I was not strong enough to deal with those things. And now as I get older, I realize if I don't deal with those toxic aspects of my life right now, I'll come back 5 years later. It's going to be the same thing. The thing hasn't changed.
Even right? worse. Can't change even worse. Because you keep piling up stuff. You keep piling up.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, I definitely agree with that. And while you were telling your experience, that story, I think one useful question that we can all ask ourselves if we're in that point, if we're trying to use COVID or political agendas or anything to just pick a fight, ask yourself, why are you so angry? Because it's probably not because of COVID. It's probably not because of the vaccine. It's probably not because of blue or red states. There might be something else there. And it takes bravery to see beyond that and to take action. Again, it's about taking action. We can all write things and say stuff about anything, but it's what are you doing to improve your life? And I think you're an example of that. You've taken action to live at peace first with yourself. because in that way
and
we
it's
can
not
all
always
live
easy.
in a peaceful way. It's not easy. No, it's never easy. Never, it's never easy. That's why not so many people do it.
But what I always remind myself is, you know, when I look back on my life, the things that I'm truly proud of are never the things that came easily.
Mm-hmm.
Right? So that's what kind of gives me the strength to keep going and keep working to resolve things that were very painful and that may still mm-hmm. be quite painful, but we're never going to be able to go back in time and make these things so that they never happened, because that's going to change everything. Like it's we're no longer going to be the same people. So just accepting, hopefully even becoming smarter, better, stronger as a result of that, I think is actually quite a beautiful thing that we should, at least I try to strive for myself, is okay, how do I learn from that? How do I become better? How do I make sure I'm not living in the same loop of just repeating, like whether that's with relationships, oh, it's the same person that I'm going for, the same exact person. They look different. They're from different places, but they're the same exact person. I have not learned that lesson. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah, totally. Trust me, I know.
The toxicity. Yeah.
Oh my God.
And also being kind to ourselves. None of this stuff is easy.
Voluntary,
you know,
kindness.
Voluntary kindness
comes from
ourselves.
You. Yeah, to ourselves.
You know, we can be really, really hard on ourselves. I don't know if that's like an Asian woman thing, but oof. Like, I'm very judgmental.
It's real.
It's very real. And like, that's not the way to heal. You know, if you want other people to have empathy, then you have to give that to yourself too. Mm-hmm. So yeah, my hope for the world is that we just start to heal. And if we can heal more, we can find peace, because we will be at peace.
Mm-hmm.
Right. And I think there's a lot of people who are still stuck in their pain, and I feel for those people. I do. And I hope that they can find the strength to figure out what happened, like acknowledge it and not just hide it or push it back down. Say, okay, this happened. That was terrible. Now what? And work towards resolving it, and knowing that, you know, whether you believe in any higher power or whatever, you're still here. After COVID happened, we're still here. We're still alive. After everything we've experienced in our lives, we're still here. We're still alive. That is something to be grateful for.
Totally.
And we've always overcome everything that's ever been thrown our way. So just know that this too shall pass. We're strong. We're still here. There are people who love and support you, right?
Totally. I love what you're saying. And if anyone listening to this like feels, okay, yeah, I don't know where to start. I have good news for you. The best way to start is through our values, to the live and let live values. They're very easy to follow, and it's simple, you know, it's simple. We want to make the world a better place. So first we have to make our own world a better place. And again, I feel that the aspirational values of this movement are aligned exactly with that, with being a better human being, with being a good person. That's all. It's all that it takes. And yeah, well, it's more than just COVID mandates, and it's more than just COVID regulations. You see, there's always something more. That's just the surface. And from Live and Let Live, we also tell you, seek always for the truth, and just go further in everything that you're thinking and saying.
Yeah, and I think it's funny, because I think seeking the truth or discerning what's fact and what's not is becoming more difficult. Like, we're so inundated with all of these, you know, clickbait, and it's just bad. There's like so much stuff. You wake up, you're like, oh my gosh, this barrage of just information, and I don't know what's right, and we don't know if the news is right. We don't know. It's exhausting. It's so
exhausting.
Much to take on. And you know, I think that's something that I really appreciate about the fact that we have so many different communities around the world. Like, I like to get my information from the different chapters. because they have no reason to lie. They have no, they have nothing to gain from, you know, leading all of us live and let livers in other areas of the world to believe something that's happening in their country. So I'm finding out stuff about what's happening in Italy, what's happening in all these different countries that I would have never, they're not going to show that on the news here in Hawaii, what's happening in Italy, what's, you know, so I like to get news from people who are in the, in that country that I know we share certain principles and values, and to get kind of the real story. So
yeah,
I would love to see, you know, and I know it doesn't sell from a traditional news standpoint because they just want to see like murder, death, war, famine, like all these things that you're like, oh my God.
Yeah.
I want to hear the story of like the kid who, you know, he went to a house trick-or-treating and there was no candy and he gave some of his candy back so other kids could have candy, or like, you know, the little things where people are just kind on their own volition because it's the right thing to do and they felt like it was the right thing to do and nobody's watching them. Nobody had a camera. Like, those are the stories, which I don't really know how we would hear those stories, but you know what I mean? That's what I want to hear. Just people being kind, because that's what renews my faith in humanity again. I think we need that. It can be definitely too depressing otherwise.
There's definitely more kindness and more good people in the world than there's bad people. Otherwise, we wouldn't be here. We'd still be like fighting in wars, like in war. Yeah, but we are here, and I think that's a good indicator, and we just have to stand up and start to speak up. And that's also something that we do here in Live and Let Live, is like to say, hey, you know what? We're tired of the things, of how things are going in the world, and we're taking a stand. We're doing something about it, because I know for sure there are more of us. And yeah, we're just starting, but if anything of this is resonating with you, everything we've said so far, please reach out, send us a message, share this video, please, with your friends, with your family. There's more of us. We just have to take the chance of speaking up, you know, and having the confidence to do so. And that's what we're here for, to support that.
So how can they find out more? How can they find you? And
Follow us on Live and Let Live Movement here on Instagram. If you're watching this on YouTube, you are already on our YouTube channel, Live and Let Live. And you can also visit liveandletlive.org. Or just send us a DM here on Instagram or on YouTube, wherever you are. We'll be happy to connect.
And you will very rarely see women like Maria asking you to slide on into those DMs. So take the opportunity, guys.
Take the chance. Take the opportunity. And also to all the girls who need more, like, we need other voices. We need much more diversity in the world. We're not alone. There's much more of us. So just reach out. We're a peaceful world, so I assure you this is going to be a great place to start.
Ojalá.
Simon, I don't know if you have any final comments, any final quotes. We have questions, throughout the whole life, so we're running out of time, so I don't want to try.
Yeah, I was just going to say that if you guys want us to talk about a certain topic, or you have somebody that you really want to see on this IG Live, just send us a little message and say, hey, you got to interview this person, you got to talk about this thing, please let us know. And also go to www.liveandletlive.org.
Thank you.
yeah, that way you can stay on top of everything that's happening. So we're just grateful that you came to have this little talk with us, and I guess until next Wednesday.
Thank you so much to all of you who connected, who are here with us, and if you're watching this also, thank you so much. Remember to share this video with that person that you were thinking the entire life. Okay, so share the video, share the love, and we'll see you next Wednesday. Ciao.
Bye.